Talk Shoe. Recorded live.
Hello, folks. This is Mike again, and I'm with Jorg from the Jugular 66. Going to have another conversation, and Jorg has a lot, sounds like a lot of information to share with you, and I think I'm going to tie it up from the last show and go from there, but I'll let Jorg explain what he's up to, and how you doing, man? How you doing today?
I'm quite fine, Michael. Thank you.
Good.
I just finished my dinner because over here it is already 8 o'clock in the evening. And my mother made a fresh cooked Italian vegetable soup called minestrone.
Ah, yeah.
Oh, was delicious. I ate a lot of it, so maybe I have to take a bathroom break in between, but I will tell you.
Okay.
I will warn you if I have to leave for 2 minutes or so.
That's fine, man.
Yeah. I prepared a little bit for the reading or the studying that we're going to do tonight. Last time we were on this document, The Vatican and the Jesuits, as you probably remember. In the introduction, I read about the Vatican institutions, like the Military Order of Malta, who control the United Nations, NATO, European Commission, the CFR, the central banks, big corporations, numerous secret societies and cults. And we went through all that, and we went through the Masonic cities, you know, the connection between Vatican City of London, the Square Mile, or the Crown, as it's also called, and, of course, the District of Columbia, which includes Washington, D.C., with its satanic street layout. And then we went on to read about different political and judicial meddling that comes with the Jesuits and the social perversions. And, of course, then we ended at the Military Order of Malta operations, so the so-called Knights of Malta, or the Military Order of Malta, actually is called the SMOM. So when you ever see that written somewhere in capital letters, SMOM, that stands for the Supreme Military Order of Malta. And what is the Knights of Malta organization mainly involved in? It is working for and with the black nobility, the Vatican, and the various papal and royal orders, especially the Jesuits, who are ultimately in control of the Vatican and the Military Order of Malta. This is something you cannot leave out. This is really important to understand. When you read that someone who is in the United States government in any function, whether it is like in the past, for example, I give you Dulles, that you know from, who was the CIA director in the 1960s. You have the Dulles brothers, you know, these two guys.
Okay.
And Dulles, who was a Knight of Malta, who was the head of the CIA. And that is the reason why JFK got killed, because JFK brought his brother in, and he wanted to take the control of the Vatican, of the CIA. He wanted it under his control, and that's why they killed him. Not because of his secret society speech, or because he printed those few dollars or whatever. It was because he touched someone who was untouchable. He touched the Knight of Malta in the very high ranking, and he was not supposed to do that, and that's why he had to pay. Of course, when you know that also, for example, Fidel Castro, the president of Cuba, is a Jesuit-educated Knight of Malta, then you know why all the so-called CIA's attempts to kill him did not bear any fruit, because they never really tried to do, because he's untouchable.
Mm-hmm.
Members of the Military Order of Malta, Knights of the Military Order of Malta, are sometimes really, really very, very high-positioned people within this whole organization, within this whole hierarchy of the so-called New World Order. And For example, Rupert Murdoch, who runs the Fox studios in the United States of America, the whole Fox News and Entertainment company, he's a Knight of Malta. So when you do not know who the Knight of Malta are, this evening is a little bit dedicated to bring that closer to your attention, that you understand what these people are, and don't forget they are ultimately controlled by the Jesuits. So they are also just frontmen to do the acting for the Jesuits, because the Jesuits are also called, you probably heard that before, the hidden hand.
Mm-hmm.
They are always in the background. The hidden hand is always in the background. The hidden hand is the hand that plays the chords where all the puppets dance to.
Yep.
Yeah. And they are in control because of their, most and for all, fear policy that they do. Second of all, because of their money policy that they do. Because when they want you to work for them and you agree, you are getting paid a shitload of money. You don't have to care for money for the rest of your world anymore, and you can be famous and you can get all the stuff that you want as long as you do what they say. But also with that, they have you in your hand. And because all these people are not in the Christian way of thinking, of knowing that everything in this world is just materialistic and, just about money and sex and I don't know what else I can sum up, but it's not about their real life. These people are always fear for their life here. Where actually, when they would be Christians and would accept Jesus Christ as the Savior, they wouldn't need to care for this life anymore because they knew there was something better waiting for them.
Right.
But, of course, in this way, these people are always targets to get... bought over, bribed, you know, you can get bribed and can put under pressure to do the things that they have to do. And even when they are in the order order of the Knights of Malta, they still have to listen to their superiors, of course. But over the superiors, and so we are going to speak to a little bit later. But you really have to understand that the Supreme Military Order of Malta is the most powerful controlling inner core at the and the inner core of that is the Order of the Garter, which you've probably heard of too, whereas, for example, Queen Elizabeth is as Dame of Malta, also a member of the Order of the Garter, which is in turn controlled by the Pilgrim Society. So there are a lot of societies, secret societies, knighthoods, and all these things intertwined together. And, in the Commonwealth of Nations, headed by Elizabeth II, it's made up of 53 nations spanning the globe, accounting for one-fifth of the landmass of the Earth and a very high percentage of its strategic resources and population. Though nominally an alliance of independent states, the Commonwealth was itself founded in the late 19th century as a perpetuation of the British Empire. And Queen Elizabeth II is heading that, and she is a member of the Order of the Garter, the Dame of Malta. So she also is under Jesuit control, even though, actually, Great Britain supposedly is a Protestant country still. Right?
Right. Supposedly.
So we can look a little bit into global business operations, for example, that are run by the military Order of Malta. Central banks and their superstructure, the BIS, also known as the Bank for International Settlements, which was founded in 1930 in Switzerland with 55 central bank members. You know, the Bank of International Settlements is the bank of the banks. It is the mother of all central banks worldwide. All national central banks, like the Federal Reserve, like the German Bundesbank, like... the Swiss Bundesbank or whatever, all these central banks that the countries have, they are in an organization where the Bank for International Settlements is the mother bank.
Mm-hmm.
That is in Zurich in Switzerland, and the bank is owned by, you may guess?
The Vatican.
Yeah, but not directly. It's owned by the Rothschilds.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay. And of course, via the Rothschilds, it's owned by the Vatican. Okay. Examples for these central banks I have here, the Bank of England from 1694, the Banque de France, that's the Bank of France, from 1716 and 1800, the U.S. Federal Reserve from 1913, the Vatican Bank from 1942. The Vatican Bank, don't think that the Vatican Bank is under the rule of the Vatican, it's under the rule of the Jesuits.
Absolutely it is,
The Deutsche Bundesbank, and of course in Europe, the ECB, the European Central Bank that we have right now with this euro. And that is now for the moment, I think, I don't know, how many countries do we have the euro? 12, 13? I don't know. I don't follow that anymore. Anywhere where I go, I can pay with the euro. So the U.S. Federal Reserve ownership, if you are interested in reading that a little bit, who owns the Federal Reserve? M.M. Warburg & Co., that is an old company from 1798, banking company from 1798, coming from Germany, from Hamburg, where I come from. Chase Manhattan Bank, founded in 1799, from the U.S. Nathan Meyer Rothschild & Sons, founded 1811 in London. Lazar Brothers Bank, 1848 in the United States. Israel Moses Sieff, a bank from Italy. And Lehman Brothers, founded in 1850 by the United States, in the United States of America, and Kuhn, also known as Kuhn and Loeb, from 1867, that is now part of Lehman Brothers, and of course Goldman Sachs, founded 1869. All these are the banks that own the Federal Reserve. And when you go into the Federal Reserve, that is a very, very interesting subject, but that is going too deep, as we could go here tonight and there, but it is said, I think, by Eustace Mullins, somewhere I read that the deposit that was made by everybody for the founding of the Federal Reserve, only the government of the United States of America deposited real gold, no, we just gave paper.
That's figures.
It wouldn't surprise me if that was true, but
no.
With Eustace Mullins also you have to be very careful, but because I learned that he was a Jesuit coadjutor.
Really?
Yeah.
I never heard that one before. I know he claimed to be a Christian, and I know that he exposed it, but then again, I guess if he wasn't exposing going all the way, it could be. You know, now that you're saying that, there's a high probability. Because he didn't spend much time talking about the Jesuit connection and the Vatican connection, did he?
Now, the little-known but extremely powerful Bank for International Settlements, so BIS, spent the 1930s and 1940s quietly laundering the Nazis' ill-gotten gains under a cloak of neutrality. So they washed all the Nazi money they have there. What are they doing? They are doing banks. Examples of Citibank, Bank of America. They are both Jesuit controlled. Yeah? Citibank and Bank of America.
Yes.
They do investment banking by real estate investment, development, venture capital, hedge funds, security trading, secret banking and offshore banking, insurance companies, global control funding organizations, for example, one. The Rockefeller Foundation from 1913, founded by Pilgrim Society and Knight of Malta members John D. Rockefeller Sr., along with his son John D. Rockefeller Jr. and Sr.'s principal business and philanthropic advisor Frederick T. Gates in the New York State in 1913. The Ford Foundation, the IMF, or International Monetary Fund, and the World Bank Group. The World Bank came into formal existence on 27th of December 1945 following international ratification of the Bretton Woods Agreement, which emerged from the United Nations Monetary and Financial Conference from the 1st to the 22nd of July in 1944. Technically, the World Bank is part of the United Nations system. Yeah? And over the United Nations, we were speaking already last time when we went into Ellis Bailey and all the connections over there and what the UN stands for and what's it all connected to. And here you see again these interconnecting there, so it's all connected. So what are the different World Bank connections, divisions, International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, this one that you have, the International Finance Corporation, International Development Association, International Center for Settlement of Investment Disputes, 1966 founded, Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency. See also the World Bank Institute, 1955, formerly named the Economic Development Institute, Independent Evaluation Group. All this brings together organizations and individuals which support the establishment of a global federal system of strengthened and democratized, global institutions with plenary constitutional power accountable to the citizens of the world and the division of international authority among separate global agencies, has had the special consultative status with the ECOSOC since 1970 and is affiliated with the UN Department of Public Information. So then you have a European Investment Bank, then you have the United Nations Capital Development Fund, you have the Asia Foundation, United Nations Foundation, and you have Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation from the year 2000 on. I guess that's something that you heard about. Because the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is the largest transparently operating charitable
it's the largest publicly recognized charitable organization, so you're saying?
Yeah, charitable by meaning of, yeah, charitable, what you call charitable, you know.
Philanthropic. I guess they donated how much? How many billion?
Charitable for the outside, but not for the inside. It seems for the outside charitable, but it is not. So, you put it not in brackets, but between, you know, hyphens or whatever.
Yeah.
How do you call that? That's what I meant by
it. Well, you look at their involvement with eugenics and the vaccine program and everything.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, they're turning out to be pretty shady characters. Who they have company with is.
Yeah, interesting. Interesting is what stands here is that the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is controlled by three trustees. First of all, the Club of Rome member, Knight Commander of the Order of the British Empire, Bill Gates. Bilderberg member, Kappa Alpha Theta fraternity member, Melinda Gates. And insurance billionaire, Warren Buffett. Several trilateral commission members also work for this charity project. Bill Gates in the Club of Rome, and Knight Commander of the Order of the British Empire? Seems to me quite high position. And then his wife, Bilderberg member, Kappa Alpha Theta fraternity member, Melinda Gates, and Warren Buffett. Now, I know that Bill Gates is not the poorest man on earth. Warren Buffett isn't the poorest man on earth, but even these two combined together with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, then you can probably guess what they can achieve when they put all their money together, you know.
Absolutely.
It's for the so-called charitable goals, where there's nothing charitable on, except if you want to die because of vaccines and birth control and all that stuff. So there are also not only bank companies, but there are also, of course, information corporations, media, software, IT, electronics, telecom. It's all under the control of the Sovereign Military Order of Malta. Don't forget, that's what we are reading right now. Entertainment distractions, fear propaganda and mind control operations, informational repression, perpetual copyrights, idea monopolies with patents, DRM information, flow control, surveillance networks, and social tracking. Social tracking, well, surely today when you think of Facebook, Google+, Twitter, all these things, all the companies behind that, they are all working for the same agenda and for the same people, and they are all controlled by the Military Order of Malta.
Hmm. So, you know, for Bill Gates, do you know much about his early years? Was he like someone who was became a Knights of Malta? Was is he born into that?
Who?
Bill Gates. Because, you know, they make this big old story up about him that he was like some nobody that built up this company.
Yeah, that he worked in the garage and then accident found all that stuff. Oh, yeah. Who believes? I mean, that the same idea is about when you look at this, Mike Zuckerberg, the founder of Facebook.
Yeah.
They made a movie on that.
Yeah, they did. Nice. Waste my time watching it too. Right?
Yeah, me too. Some years ago, I did that too. But then you understand. But then when you look deeper into that, then you understand that Facebook from the beginning was a CIA operation.
Right, and then Bill Gates,
Mark Zuckerberg is just a person they put out there, and let them take the earnings and let them take the credits, because they cannot say, "Oh, we at the CIA are doing this."
This is the same thing that going along with Bill Gates, right? And apparently, Bill Gates' father was CIA, and yeah, it seems to stay in the family, doesn't it?
They always work with chosen people. You can be sure about that. There's no one by accident coming really to the top. And like today, when you look at the IT market, if there is a small company that is owned by some brilliant man who is not under control of anything, and he has a very, very wonderful firm, company, then just Google comes up and says, "I'm going to buy you. How much is it?" And everybody is possible to be bought, you know.
Yes.
And then they get the control over this, you know. There is no independence in this. The only independence that we have is little broadcasts like we do here, because we are not paid by anybody. We just use the internet. But when they shut us down tomorrow, then we have to shut down also, because we don't have any other voice that we can offer to the people. We are dependent on their hardware, let's say, or software, or whatever, to use that. But we don't have the money to found our own radio station or whatever to do that. And if we did, we would probably get in trouble because of the things that we say.
Absolutely. With all the regulations and the controls. Yep. Well, at least my country, there's no such thing as free, independent news. All you have is left is what we're doing right here, you know. Mm-hmm. Shortwave or having a little, you know, show like this. Insignificant show that 99.999% of people won't ever hear. So
it's the same over here in Belgium where I live, and it's certainly the same over in Germany where I come from originally. Because, you know, in Germany there are some secret contracts made, and after the Second World War, the control of all media was given in Germany was given to the Allies until 2099. That's by contract.
Hmm.
It's a secret contract that no one should know, but you can get the information out there on that. It's called Geheimer Staatsvertrag.
One more piece of the puzzle that justifies why you call Germany the 51st state, right?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, that's right. That's right. I do that. Yeah.
And Tom Fress, he likes to call the CIA, that stands for the Catholic in Action Network.
Yeah.
Catholics in Action, CIA. So, and if you look at both those, we talked about, at least Bill Gates and their associations with Roman Catholicism. So, Knights of Malta, Roman Catholicism. You can never negate the religious element in it. So,
the Military Order of Malta is further going into military corporations, into energy and mining corporations for petroleum, for coal, for metals, for diamonds, for water. Think of water. There are privatizing the water all around the world right now, making a natural source that is absolutely vital for survival private. They run several transportation corporations in shipping, automotive, aviation, airline, and railway, like, for example, the big three, GM, Ford, and Chrysler. Is that what are the three big three in the United States? All run by Knights of Malta. I know that Lee Iacocca was a Knight of Malta. I searched that one way. So, you know, all these transportation corporations, all the big ones, are, of course, in this scheme in there. Mercedes, BMW, Volkswagen, Porsche, we've got all the German companies in there, of course. And Opel, which is now General Motors, of course. Pharmaceutical corporations are all under their control, and food corporations. So food corporations, there's something interesting. Probably you heard about the Svalbard Global Seed Vault. Did you?
Yeah, is that the one you're talking about? It's in Iceland or Greenland?
Yes, it's a vault that is up there in Scandinavia somewhere.
Okay, yeah, there you are, yeah.
Where all the seeds, all the original seeds of the world are taken care of deep underground in a vault.
Yeah.
So, Jesuit Georgetown University alumni, European Commission President José Manuel Barroso. So he was, up to a few months ago, the European Commission President, and by that, the man with the highest power in Europe, never elected, but selected in that position. And he is Jesuit Georgetown University alumni. And Nobel Peace Prize winner Wangari Maathai of Kenya were among the dozens of guests who had bundled up for the ceremony inside the vault. Dug into the permafrost of the mountain, it has been built to withstand an earthquake or a nuclear strike. The operation is funded by the Global Crop Diversity Trust, which was funded by the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization and Biodiversity International, a Rome-based research group. So, you know, they take all the original seeds in there, dug them deep in the ground, and then they poison up with GMOs.
Agenda 21, right?
Of course, because Monsanto has only one goal, and that is the food supply worldwide. And do that with Monsanto, Syngenta, DuPont, mix the three companies, and you have worldwide control of the food chain. And when you control the food and the water and the money and the energy, well, nowhere else to turn to, is it?
No. It sounds an awful lot like we're returning back to the feudal ages or the dark age, the feudal period of the Western
absolutely,
Europe.
Absolutely, yeah. But that is absolutely the way that we are on, because in the time before the Reformation, the so-called dark ages, where the Pope had control over the then known world, and he was the one who crowned the kings, and without the Pope, the Pope's authority, no king could ever reign or do anything. You only had two classes. You had the nobles, the people with money and standing, and you had the poor people, the peasants, and you had no middle class.
All right.
That is what the Reformation gave us, and that is the big enemy of Rome. And that's what they are trying to take away from us ever since. And of course, the new world order is actually nothing else than just the reinstatement of the old world order under new conditions, of course, because we are 500-600 years later now. But the point is, just as the Pope was the head of the world governments in the dark ages, the Pope wants to be the same now in these ages, and that's the new world order, it's nothing else. And whether it's the Pope or someone else they put in front of you, it is behind the scenes the Pope or the Black Pope that pulls the strings.
It's extremely tragic the more and more you think about it, you know. I know one thing, it just makes you more and more want to lean on Jesus Christ and believe in him, because there is no hope. And if we take what the Bible says seriously, this new round is going to be horrendous for the whole world.
But, you know, the most interesting thing is the further we go to read into this document, the further we see how deep all these connections are.
Uh-huh.
And how they are all intertwined, and that you see that this is really a web, like a spider's web, where once you get caught, and you have no way out of it anymore. Because wherever you turn to, you run into Big Brother. You know?
Yep.
I mean, it's like with these various other corporations that the sovereign military order of Malta controls. And how do they control this? Well, at the annual meetings of the secretive Bilderberg Group. Have you ever heard of the Bilderbergers?
Of course, yes.
Yeah, they were founded in my neighbor state here, the Netherlands, in Holland, the Netherlands, in a hotel that was called, that's called the Bilderberger Hotel. And that group was founded by Knight of Malta Joseph Ratzinger in 1954. And that is a geopolitically important business. There are geopolitically important business deals are made. And they meet every year at least once. One meeting is always very already put out in the media. Not in the mainstream media, but in the alternative media, it's very known. But the point is that this Bilderberg Group has working cycles, working groups, a working group for this and a working group for that, and these groups come together more than once in a year. So this Bilderberg meeting that we are talking about, it's only one meeting that's once a year, where all these groups come together and all the same 200 people come in, but you have in the Bilderbergers, you have a core and a core group, and of course organizations that they are all in. And who is coming to Bilderberg meetings? Well, people like the CEO of Google, the CEO of Apple, the CEO of big insurance companies, banking companies, transportation companies like car builders, people from politics, whether it's a minister or even a prime minister, may go into that secret meeting, although that I think in every country it is forbidden for everyone who is in the high position in government to participate in a secret meeting, but they don't care, they go anyway. You know?
Yeah. And Ratzinger, if you look at him, first of all, even at the doors, does a really good video of that, of him in particular, and how it does very persuasive, presents a very persuasive argument that Ratzinger is one of the most, if not one of the most influential men of the last century. It's so few of us know who this man is. And it's interesting to look at his, once again, his Nazi connections and his Catholic connections.
Mm-hmm.
Knights of Malta.
And he was Knight of Malta. Yeah. Okay. Where do the Knight of Malta politically and judicial meddling do? And the Order of Malta retains its claim of sovereignty under international law and has been granted permanent observer status at the United Nations. It issues its own passports, stamps, and coins. The Order of Malta has diplomatic relations with 100 countries, and its sovereignty is recognized by 105 states. I think this is news that some people didn't know yet. How do they manage the global control structures via political structures, global and financial structures that we've seen above? Also via the United Nations, 1919 to 1945, formerly called the League of Nations. You know, the predecessor of the United Nations was the League of Nations, where the United States didn't want to be a part of. And then they got them in 45 with the United Nations. Mm-hmm. The Order of Malta has permanent missions to the United Nations and these specialized agencies. The UNESCO, which stands for Education, Science and Culture. The World Food Program, IFAD, which stands for agriculture, the WHO, World Health Organization, healthcare, and High Commissioner for Refugees, High Commissioner for Human Rights, and UNIDO, which stands for Industrial Development. It has permanent court arbitration since 1899 with the Carnegie Foundation. The Carnegie Foundation in 1903 donated $1.5 million for the construction, management, and maintenance of the Peace Palace. The Peace Palace was built to the House of Permanent Court and Arbitration and the Library of International Law. From 1922 on, the building also housed distinct and separate Permanent Court of International Justice, which later became the International Court of Justice in 1945. So we have here Andrew Carnegie, who is from the Pilgrim Society, a member. You know, Pilgrim Society, big in control, yeah? And sometimes referred to as the second richest man in history. Carnegie Mellon University, 1900, Carnegie Endowment for International Peace and Waterloo Peace Prize Award since 1931 by the Carnegie Foundation. International Court of Justice, 1945. Of course, we have in The Hague, the Academy of International Law, which is all controlled by the Sovereign Military Order of Malta, the Socialist Fascist European Union, which is its 1947 origins of the European movement founded by Knight of Malta Joseph Ratzinger, who we just talked about, who also founded the Bilderberg in 54, and related institutions and projects. They meddle also with the World Trade Organization, which was founded in 1944, the WTO. The Order of Malta is also a member of these international organizations, the International Committee of the Red Cross from Geneva, International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, also from Geneva, 1919, International Committee of Military Medicine, International Institute of Unification of Private Law, Council of Europe and European Commission, and also European Council. Not one of us can read minutes of Committee of Permanent Representatives, the EU executive body comprised of unelected and mostly unknown national bureaucrats known as permanent representatives, in contrast to elected ones, for God's sake. It pre-cooks 90% of Brussels legislation and prepares the agenda for the EU's highest and most secret plenary body, the European Council. Because don't think that the European Parliament has anything to say. All the people who are sitting there in the European Parliament are just paid puppets. They don't have anything to say. The laws are made with the European Commission. And by that, Manuel Barroso, which I talked earlier about, who was until a few months the head of the European Commission, was the most powerful person in Europe because he made his laws and nobody elected him, you know? Nobody elected him. He was selected by the European Council. The European Council, it will come together from all the heads of state of the countries who are in the European Union. And they elect or select some people for this commission, for this powerful for this powerful position. Under the Lisbon Treaty, the European Council would become a formal institution with the power of appointing the commission. It could be said that the two bodies, the European Commission and the European Council, hold the executive power of the Union. Yeah. And nothing to do with the European Parliament. There's absolutely nothing to say about that. Probably something that my European friends are more aware of than you is Echelon. Have you heard of that?
I've heard of it.
Yeah.
But I don't know much about it, to be honest with you, but I have heard of it.
Echelon, Echelon is a global unified intelligence service, including Echelon. So they are the Knights of Malta managing the global unified intelligence service, including Echelon, and the specific secret services to defend and promote the Vatican Jesuit Masonic interests. This unified international intelligence community was built during Rome's Second Thirty Years' War, 1914 to 1945, and perfected during Rome's subsequent Cold War between 1945 and 1990. Echelon is, well, everybody speaks now about the NSA and this so-called scandal that is coming out, that the NSA is controlling everybody and reading everybody's emails and listening to everybody's telephones and all that stuff. That's already since the 90s here in Europe with this Project Echelon. I think that is based for a big part in Great Britain. That is here already normal since all these years. I mean, the lay people don't know that because they don't care for that, but they don't care for anything but the cheeseburgers and football on TV. But everybody who is a little bit into research and that knows Echelon here in Europe, and that is already much longer than this NSA scam that's now coming. And of course, next to this Unified Intelligence Service, what do you have to understand on the Unified Intelligence Service? It's very easy. You take from every country the secret service they have. Like in the United States, you have the CIA, you have the NSA, you have the FBI, probably a few more that I'm not aware about right now. But all these are intelligence agencies. And then you have in Israel the Mossad, and in Germany you have the BND, and in Russia you have, you have this KGB, which is now, I don't know, FCB or what it is called right now. It's changed its name, but it's still the same organization. All these intelligence companies are in fact under one cap that is controlled by the Supreme Military Order of Malta, which is again controlled by the Jesuits. So you can say that the Jesuits, or in other words, the Roman Catholic Church, has all the needed intelligence information worldwide, because they own or control all intelligence agencies worldwide. That's why it's such a joke. Like in German, they are playing this theater for the people with this, you know, Angela Merkel, the chancellor, her telephone was tapped by the NSA. And they make such a big scandal out of it. And did the MAD know? You know, MAD is Militärischer Abschirmdienst, that is the military intelligence agency in Germany. The MAD know, or did the BND know, Bundesnachrichtendienst, which is the CIA in German. Did they know, and why didn't they do anything? And they play a big theater there already for half a year with this hacked phone by Angela Merkel, where so-called one intelligence agency is working against another or spying in another. Dude, they are all interchangeable. They are all out there with the same agenda. Maybe not on the outside for everybody to see, but behind the scenes. Behind the scenes, and this is why it is so important that we have to put in our minds, okay, it is the military order from the Knights of Malta, but the Knights of Malta are Jesuits and or are Jesuit controlled.
Right.
And then you have just to go, really, you have to go into the oath that the Jesuits take to understand this. I always get sick when I get a comment on one of my videos where they say, well, you know, it's crypto Jews who founded the Jesuits. I say, oh my God, how is that possible? But you have to be, people are so dumb, but you have to be aware of the point that even in their own oaths, they state, and even to descend so low as to become a Jew among Jews, that you might be enabled to gather together all information for the benefit of your order as a faithful soldier of the Pope.
Yep.
that is taken directly from the oaths from the Jesuits.
Right.
And when you are aware of this, then you have a chance to see through that curtain that they throw in front of your face to blind you.
And not only that, the Jesuit oath, but it's also part of the Knights of Malta oath and the Knights of Columbus oath.
Yeah, that's right. They are all the same thing. And,
you know, interesting, you know, we talk about what a crypto Jew is. I finally have kind of figured out what it really means. And it really means is, you know, you can be, as a Jesuit, you can be a Roman Catholic Buddhist, a Roman Catholic Jew, a Roman Catholic Mormon. And so when we talk about crypto Jews, we're really talking about basically people whose first affiliation is with Roman Catholicism, who are pretending to be or posing as or participating in the Jewish faith, or the Mormon faith, or the Buddhist faith. It doesn't really matter. So when we talk about that, you know, people make a huge mistake of because they hear Jew, they think automatically that that's their first allegiance is to the Jewish faith. But no, crypto Jew means they are first and foremost in line with Rome.
I understand.
Crypto Mormons. I mean, if you look at the leadership of the Mormon Church, which is deviating a little bit from your topic, but this point, good point.
I think there is one thing that people do not understand, but they have to make a distinction between. A Jew is not a Jew.
No, not at all.
You have the so-called Jewish religion. I say so-called because that religion is not Jewish. That religion was in the Old Testament Israelic. And Judah was just one of the 12 tribes. So you have the religion the Jews follow. On the other hand, you have the race of the Jews from the tribe of Judah. The descendants of the old tribe of Judah, like you have descendants of the old tribe of Benjamin and of Naphtali and all the other 12 and together. So you have Jews by blood and you have Jews by belief. You know, I found it always very funny when you watch some Hollywood movie and then someone has to convert to the Jewish belief because they want to go marry. And I say, so his blood changes now or what? You can become a Jew. You cannot become a Jew. Whether you're a Jew, that's genetic, that's your race, you are from that tribe, or you are not. You can assume the belief. Yeah, okay, I can become a Hindu, but I will not become an Indian, you know?
Right.
My DNA is not changing. I'm not getting brown from tomorrow on just because I'm saying I'm a Hindu now. So, and that distinction makes it so hard. So who is now a Jew who should be, like, let's call it protected or whatever? The Jew who is a Jew by blood or the Jew who is a Jew by confession?
Yeah.
And there is not this distinction made in the outside world. And that is why, for example, AIPAC, this American Israeli propaganda agency, community, how I call it, AIPAC,
right,
is such a heavy, heavy organization with such a heavy influence in the United States of America. Because the most Jews who are running that are just Jews by what they say, belief, you know, by conversion. Other people speak then of the Khazars. And Ashkenazi and all that stuff. I don't want to go into that because there's too much disinformation on that subject to go into that Khazar and then Nazi stuff and Ashkenazi stuff. But you have to understand that a lot of Jews who are put out there are just Jews by accepting that belief system and have nothing to do with being descendants from the original tribe of Judah. Where that actually came from. I think that's something for our listeners also to consider a little bit.
Yeah. And then if you deal with biblically that, you know, the 70 weeks of Daniel and then the end of the Jewish era, you know, at the stoning of Stephen, and it just goes on and on and on. You know, the fact of the matter is it's just been used as a scapegoat by the Jesuits and by Rome to vet everyone's racist tendencies and anger at somebody. And, of course, you know, let's set it towards the Jews instead of the actual true culprits or what's going on, which is always Rome. It's always Rome. And it's in the Jesuit order of its machinations. So. But that's what it does. It always uses these front groups to hide what it's doing. So, yeah. But most folks, because we're inherently lazy, and then on top of that, being taught to be lazy, you know, we don't go very much deeper in finding out the truth about, you know, who are the Jews, what's their role in all of everything in the world, you know. But at some point, you have to realize, you would come to this realization, there's no way that the Jews could have enough power to do what is being done in this world. There has to be an organization that, and that organization, as you learn, it turns out to be Rome. Because only when they're wealthy enough, powerful enough to actually do the things that need to be done in this world in order to have a one-world government. So.
Yeah, but for the moment, we are living in the time of the Gentiles. And when you understand that, then you always know that there cannot be a Jew on the top of something, you know?
True.
But what these organizations like the Jesuits do, and what they love to do, is put out someone to take the blame for them.
Yeah.
So when they make it seem to people who do research and stuff like we do, but they don't do it so deep like we did, okay? But most of the people who do this research and who hang on Alex Jones and Texan Mars and David Icke and all these people, and when the Jesuits succeed in putting in front of all these truth-hungering people, Jews, as the culprits, they initiate hate. Sorry. They initiate hatred. And they initiate anti-Semitism. Even the subject of anti-Semitism, sorry, it's really another subject than just the subject about the Jews, because even the Jews are not Semites.
Right.
But that's something else. Let's just talk in terms of how the people who are living in the Matrix understand this topic. And they are being set up to blame the Jews. That is exactly what Hitler used in the 1930s. When he was speaking about the Jewish banking empire and all that stuff. But I just read it. Who owns the Federal Reserve? Who owns all these banks? The Knights of Malta. The Knights of Malta are not Jewish. And the Jesuits behind them are not Jewish. But that's who runs it. We are living in the times of the Gentiles and not in the times of the Jews. But that doesn't mean that the Jews are there to take the blame, because they are put out there to take the blame.
Yep.
And they do that already since hundreds of years, and they do it very successfully. And of course, the Jews who are selling themselves out for this are responsible to what is done to their fellow brethren. If you ask me who is responsible for the Holocaust, which is not a subject that I will go into, but that's most of all the Rothschilds.
Yeah.
Because they let it happen. They are controlled by the Knights of Malta. They are even themselves Knights of Malta and other knighthoods. They are controlled by the Jesuits, and they are, with their family there, they let it happen. The history of the Rothschilds is very interesting. And I've seen something in the text that I'm reading whether it's this text that I hear right now or the one that we are going to read later on, where we come into the founding of the Rothschilds in that time.
All right.
So
the other thing is, too, when we look at World War II, when we look at the late 20s, early 30s, Rome, when we talk about Roman Jews, crypto Jews, what Rome did is they sent a bunch of what quote-unquote crypto Jews into Germany with money and bought up all this depressed land, you know, this land that lost all its value at cheap, and use them as a scapegoat, and then, you know, made this whole story, a scenario that it's the Jews are the one that are ruining Germany. The Jews are running the economy. When in truth, if you look at the historical facts about it, Rome had actually gave these Jewish crypto Jews financial support and aid to actually do that. And then they turned it around and then used that as a way to, instead of having the focus, once again, because this is what the Jesuits do, instead of having the focus on them, they always have it on the scapegoat, a group, somebody, you know, that the rest of the world sees, but never the Jesuits. So they used the Jews as an excuse. And the Rothschilds were a big part of that whole scenario.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And not only the Rothschilds, but also Warburg, which is also a Jewish company, and Kuhn and Loeb, which is also a Jewish company, but formerly coming from Germany, with this banking house there, that are also partakers of the Federal Reserve. That was really
right.
I'd like to continue in my text. We're speaking about the Sovereign Military Order of Malta managing the global unified intelligence services and what includes all that. So understand that all intelligence agencies all around the world are gathered together under a so-called Unified Intelligence Service, and that is run by the Knights of Malta. And, of course, all the military structures like NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, United Nations troops, and Blackwater private military, Blackwater, which is, I think, today called EX, and which is just mercenaries, people who get hired and paid to go out for war, to go out for terrorist attacks and all that stuff. That is where all these people come from when you hear that somebody put a car bomb here or blow himself up or blew himself up. This is all in working together with NATO and NATO secrets, NATO secret organizations, like you had that here in Europe, Gladio. You heard about that? Gladio?
Gladio, I've heard of it. Once again, another topic that I've not really done much research.
There is some like the fifth column or structures of NATO left behind to fight back if the so-called Russians got us here, so that they were the last base off, and Gladio was connected into crimes and everything else. Like here in Belgium, where I was, there was some 20, 30 years ago, there was this Colruyt gang. Colruyt is a big supermarket, and these supermarkets were all robbed. And there was Gladio behind that. There's a very interesting researcher from Switzerland. His name is Dr. Daniele Ganza. And you can look him up. He does very interesting lectures, also in English, about Gladio, and tells that out. So Gladio is more like, let us call, the terrorist department of NATO. And, of course, you have the same in Blackwater or EX, whatever, where you work with mercenaries. Don't forget the French Foreign Legion, it's called.
Yep.
Yeah. They are also used for these tactics, for terrorism and all that stuff, to put in there. So, all that under the control of the Knights of Malta. And what policy propaganda for the purpose of social, commercial, and military control do we have that is also controlled by the Knights of Malta? International policies. You have the Chatham House that is founded in 1920, EU-based, formerly called the Royal Institute of International Affairs. Or RIAA, since maybe you've heard of that before. But Chatham House is interconnected also with the Club of Rome. Then you have the International Institute for Strategic Studies, which is 1958 founded and EU-based. Then you have, of course, the Club of Rome. You have the Trilateral Commission, which was founded in 1973. You have the special international policies like the Tavistock Institute, which is for social psychology politics, Aspen Institute, US-based, Senless Council, 2002, EU-based drug policy institute with offices in Afghanistan, Kabul, Kandahar, and Lashkargah. Drug policy institute in Afghanistan. Okay. Where, you know, before the United States of America invaded, the crops went down, and the opium production is on an all-time high since the Americans have been there.
Yep.
So who is running the drugs? Normal people or the government? Then you have also Transatlantic, the Economic Council from 2007, which is under their control, and national policies. You have Brookings Institution. You have the Council on Foreign Relations, and you see that directly when you go on their website with the Pegasus that they have, this flying horse. The American Enterprise Institute, the John Birch Society, Cato Institute, the Council on National Policy. The John Birch Society is controlled by the Sovereign Military Order of Malta, who is a famous member of the United States of America of the John Birch Society. Ron Paul.
Yep.
So, where is his allegiance to? Huh?
Rome.
Of course. You don't get any points for that answer, Monica.
I know.
Too easy.
I know. I just find, you know, my journey, it just becomes so, the overwhelming evidence that Rome's involvement in our day-to-day lives and what's going on, geopolitics, it just becomes so pointless. Like, that's the answer. The default answer to everything is Rome. The Jesuits in Rome, because it's the truth, and it's just really, it's very, I understand why a lot of folks go, well, can you guys talk about something else? The problem is, if we're going to have an honest discussion, it still goes back to Rome.
Yeah, you know, everybody knows that saying, all roads lead to Rome. But never anybody is really thinking about what they just said.
No, it's just a cliche from the past,
it's
right?
Just a cliche, yeah. And do you know where that comes from?
The cliche?
Because Rome was the first real society that we had here in Europe that was really much progress,
right?
And expanded by wars and everything, and they had to build roads for their troops. And because they came from Rome, where they started all the wars to, whether it was into France, into Germany, into, I don't know, Spain, wherever, all the roads came from Rome, of course, all the roads lead to Rome. Because they were built from there. That was the starting point. Not many people are aware of that. But that's the truth. It's also like we have this some ways are still today called Roman roads here in Belgium and Germany. We have that still.
Right.
They really go back 1,000, 1,500, 2,000 years to the original road that was built then. That road is already there that long. Can you believe that? We have roads here 2,000 years old.
Yeah. I mean, I saw that in Portugal and in parts of England too. So, yeah, I believe that.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's amazing how, it was the architectural wonder is, you know, in its heyday of Rome, that was basically the pagan Rome that we're talking about prior to the Holy Roman Empire.
Yeah.
With its aqueducts, its plumbing, its highway systems.
You have to understand that Rome was a city inhabited by more than 100,000 people. And they were living there in that conditions. They had all to get fresh water. access at least, and that they all had to go to the toilet.
Yeah.
It all had to be taken care of. So, yeah, that's where it goes back. But nobody ever thinks about when they say all roads lead to Rome, they never think about where does that come from and why is that? And not only why is that, but really that absolutely every road they walk on leads to Rome also today. And therefore, it is very interesting to see how they package that and how they want to take that out of the site. And that is by creating benign charity funds.
Yeah.
That's what the Military Order of Malta do. Just like the Catholic Church and the Jesuits like to do, to try and confuse people about their fascistic history and their present operations. Sometimes these seemingly harmless charity organizations are also used for information gathering and espionage in foreign countries. I give you some examples. You have the Rotary International. Over 32,000 clubs in 200 countries. See also their support for the UN globalist agenda. The Rotarians are a bit like Boy Scouts, grown old and successful. The celebrated writer ignored, no doubt, to what extent he was correct, at least regarding the common origin of the two groups. So Rotary International and the Rotarians. That's really something very interesting to go into. Father Esposito actually recalled Rotary's Masonic spirit with these enlightened words. Quote, "The existing rapport between this organization and Masonry is essential, not only because of its founding on February 23, 1905, by the lawyer Paul P. Harris of Chicago, along with three of its fellow Masons, but also because of the ideological and juridical elements borrowed from Masonry, which take the best in the initiatory message in order to insert it into the society and laicize it, that is by excluding the initiatory and restrictive aspects, which, by always excluding religious confessionalism, have a certain sacred, although lay, character." Interesting, huh?
It is.
32,000 Rotary clubs in 200 countries. That means they are everywhere.
Yeah,
absolutely everywhere. And you know what they seem to be for the outside, like this benign charity front, that's why it's called that way in the article here. For the outside, they seem to be good, but for the initiate and the higher levels, they know the real agenda. But there you have again the problem of esoteric and exoteric knowledge that has been taught.
Yeah.
And then you also have Malteser International, which was founded in 1953 as Malteser Germany, renamed in 2005, operating in 30 countries in Africa, Asia, Europe, and the Americas. Malteser organization, yeah. I know that from Germany already. Okay, I'm going to read a little bit about Catholicism and the Holy Roman Empire. How is that connected to the Jesuits?
Sounds good. Hey. Just let you know, I am listening. I'm going to have to mute myself out for a little bit as some people just showed up at the house. But we have a couple people listening as well. So I'll have my headsets on. I will be listening, but I won't be able to respond for about 5 minutes. So
okay. That's all right. I'm just going on with myself.
All right. Okay. All right.
Yeah. While the militaristic Roman Empire was collapsing, Pope Symmachus created the Vatican Palace in 514 as the seat of the universal religion called Catholicism. Universal religion, Catholicism, well, Catholic Catholicism means universal. We have to understand that. Catholicism itself was created about 150 years before by Emperor Constantine the First, using the First Council of Nicaea in 325 to control the political and spiritual uprisings among various regions, tribes, and slave groups, thereby making Constantine the first in a long series of Roman emperors, or popes, who explicitly wanted to completely rule over both the spiritual and political realm. Perhaps indicative of the lack of interest of the First Council of Nicaea and its Roman agenda was that of the 1900 invites sent to religious leaders, only about 300 participated. Well, that was not very interesting then. 1,500 people don't show up to the invitation. early Christianity-like cultures were spreading and imposing a very large threat to the Roman Empire. So the Romans institutionalized the various Christian-like cultures into a new universal religion named Catholicism. Many people still see the papacy as only a religious organization. But if one looks into their never-ending quest for the political power, you'll see that the Roman Empire and the papacy have always had the exact same goal, world domination. The differences are only in the execution of this neurotic idea. The most powerful tool of the Vatican organizations has been to take hostage the much older Judaic Christian-like cultures and force these cultures into a superficial look-alike called Catholicism, or as Roman Catholics like to say, Christendom. In many parts of the world, native people were first massively killed if their spiritual leaders could not be corrupted. Then the rest of the tribe was slowly converted into the cult of Catholicism by missionaries, using the lie that the supreme spirit they worshipped was actually the same as the one in the Roman Catholic Church. The Vatican never was a true Christian culture-based organization. It has always been an occult, esoteric or hidden, bloodthirsty political organization, which has built a deceiving, hypocritical font of religious dogma, what I was speaking about, the exoteric or the visible, derived from the ancient mysticism religions, sun worship, human and animal sacrifices, holy priests and strict obedience structures. For more than 2,000 years, all authentic Judaic Christianity-like cultures have been persecuted and often annihilated or at least severely weakened by the Vatican. Yeah, we were just talking about Constantine and 325, the Council of Nicaea. You can also name 321, where he changed the Sabbath from the biblical Sabbath, Saturday, into the first day of the week, Sunday. And that was also Constantine, and that's why he is actually, you can call it, the founder of Roman Catholicism. He was the one who melted Christianity from the followers of Jesus Christ, from these churches that were apostates of pagan Rome, of course. He melted that together with his pagan rituals, and that mixture he called Christendom, or Roman Catholicism, if you want to. Oh, there's so much stuff to talk about when we go into these parts. So very interesting. I'm just going to read on a little bit more from the history that is written down here. So, by 541, with the Council of Chalcedon, the Holy Roman Empire itself had already fractured somewhat, and with the official East-West Schism in 1054, the Orthodox Church split from the Holy Roman Empire. Why did they split from the Holy Roman Empire? Because they didn't accept the Pope as Vicar of Christ, as the God on earth. They didn't accept their hierarchy. That's why they split up in 1054. However, the Holy Roman Empire was becoming more and more dominant in Europe and reached its power peak in the 13th and 14th century. Well, that were the absolute dark ages in that time. After the Renaissance, the struggle for religious and political freedom of the various Reformation movements during the Middle Ages and up to the 18th century, some lost terrain had been regained by the Protestant nations, but the losses have been enormous, and much of the authentic spiritual basis of Christianity-like cultures has been erased from the collective memory. Almost none of the numerous Christian splinter churches today acknowledges, let alone communicates, this ancient legacy of Roman Catholic persecution, history, falsification, and spiritual perversions. Sadly, most of the so-called Christian churches today, however, are still connected to Catholicism, and thereby also the Vatican organization, in various ways, or have been infiltrated and co-opted, mainly by the Jesuits in many cases. The Vatican institution and its mafia network have always been a fascistic political organization with the cover of religious organization. The aim is and was population control, the spiritual and political realm, by any means. These two realms of domination, the spiritual and temporal, are represented by two crossed keys on the papal tiara, which can be seen in many Catholic churches and on the flag of the Vatican. Because the Pope holds the two keys of the spiritual and the temporal power. And this is exactly when you read Daniel, the prophecies of Daniel in the Old Testament, you understand that the fourth beast is different from all the other beasts. I mean, not the first beast, but the little horn. The little horn that comes out of the ten toes, where the toes are mixed, the toes and the feet of iron are mixed with miry clay. You know, the toes and the feet of iron stand for the state power, and the miry clay stands for the spiritual. And as iron and clay do not mix, so that system won't work. But that is what makes this last beast different from all the others in Daniel. And that is the combination of church and state. When you go into old Egypt, when you go into old Babylon, when you go into Medo Persia, when you go into Greek, and even when you go into the pagan Roman Empire, there had always been a division between religious and civil power. And that is what the Roman Catholic Church under Constantine did in the 320s, 330s, and the years to come, until the papacy reached its full power in 538, after having killed three big people in Europe, like the Ostrogoths, the Vandals, and there was a third one. Those were these three horns that had to be plucked out when you read the Bible. And after that, the Vatican got full power, so they had about 200 years to melt the spiritual power with the temporal or the civil power. And that's where this last beast differs from all the other beasts before him, because here you have the combination of church and state. And of course, when you understand a little bit of the Bible and all that stuff, and you know that God never wanted to have a link of church and state together, that is absolutely unbiblical. And that is what I just read, that it all comes together in this. When you look a little bit into this one world religion, you can say, okay, how are they going to do a one world religion? We have Islam, we have Christianity, we have Hinduism, we have all that stuff. Well, I made a few videos on my channel, Juggler 66, that you can have a look at. And they are called one world religion. The wound is healing. I made two videos on that. And in the second video of that, there is an article about a house of worship that is going to be built in Berlin, Germany, where there is worship for three different religious groups, namely Christianity, Jews, and Islam. These three under one roof can go there, hold their prayers, and there's a center in it when all these three can come together and worship together. That's how they try to melt these religions. And you also have Rick Warren, who in the United States of America promotes since a long time already Chrislam, which is the fusion of Christianity and Islam. Now, when you think about it, it's not so strange, because the Vatican founded Islam. And when you study it, Islam is nothing else than Roman Catholicism for Arabs. Well, if that is so, then you can also merge these two together, you know? And that eventually, I think, is one of the plans that they have. But that's the way they go for a one-world religion. And there's only one thing that came in between there, and that was the Reformation, and how the Reformation changed the Vatican control it had. Because you have to understand, until the Reformation really took foot in the 1520s, before there, there was only Vatican control. There was nothing else. But I'm going to read a little bit about Reformation and Vatican control right now. The Reformation changes since the early 16th century by the Protestants, which is actually what the Vatican called the sovereign heretics, to the political systems such as more decentralized ruling tax income, less centralism from Rome, and the millennium of battles against the oppressive Roman Empire that went before that sets the stage of an ongoing struggle by people all over the world to be able to live according to our natural birthright. Sovereignty of the body and spirit of each individual, protecting our sovereignty from state, religious, corporate, and secret society fascism is our principal collective responsibility. This shared value should be basis for our constitutional law. All other constitutional laws should be derived from this basis. The true history of the Reformation and the opposing Counter-Reformation, starting with the Ecumenical Council of Trent in 1545, however, was and still is not a simple two-side conflict between the Holy Roman Empire and the sovereign people and their nations. There is growing evidence showing that the Lutheran Reformation movement was secretly used by the Rosicrucians and later the Jesuits behind the scenes to, first, restrict the social-political effects of the Reformation on societies in Europe, and second, diminish the established power structures of the papacy so that these secret societies could infiltrate and, over time, completely take over the Vatican institution, partly from the inside and partly from the outside. They succeeded in doing this, but not without visible historic friction. Well, there's something that I want to go a little bit deeper into this, and this is about the Reformation. When it's stated here, there's growing evidence showing that the Lutheran Reformation movement was secretly used by the Rosicrucians and later the Jesuits behind the scenes. I haven't done a deep study in that, but I came across, when I studied Martin Luther, I came across the point that someone mentioned that Luther was a Rosicrucian. I don't know that. I cannot confirm that. I cannot deny that. I don't know that. I just put it out there and say there is information out there that states that Luther was a Rosicrucian. Well, let's just say that Luther was one of the most influential reformers ever. I don't want to play down the role of Wycliffe and Tyndale and Knox and Huss and Cranmer and all these other great, great people before the eye of God who gave their life for what they believed in, and they were all doing the reformers' work. But worldwide, when you, even in the English-spoken nations, when you speak about the Reformation, people come on with Luther. So let's say that he was the big Reformation figure. He had a lot of influence. I never understood, and maybe some of our listeners can give an idea to help me understand that. Luther came out of the Roman Catholic Church. And his idea was to reform the church. Now, a few points on that. Luther, like all the other reformers, identified the Roman papal system and the Pope in person as the Antichrist, as the biblical historical, and prophetic Antichrist. He did that. The other reformers did that. There's no question about that. That's why Roman Catholicism calls them heretics and wants them killed. That's why they invented this futurism idea in 1590 by Alcazar, I think was his name, and Ribera was the other. That's why they did that. But how can you reform the Church of Satan? Are you going to convert Satan to accept God as an authority again? This is something where the reformers were wrong. You have to understand there is a difference between, for example, a revolution and a rebellion. And the Reformation was a revolution, where it should have been a rebellion. The difference is, when you are in a revolution, and you take anybody out who has anything to say, who is in power, and you are going through all the powerful structures and the hierarchy, and you put everybody aside, and you replace that with new people. But you keep the old structure. That's a revolution. A rebellion is when you tear it all down. You smash it all to the ground. It's done. And you will start from grassroots, from the start, you will start a new hierarchy that is based on the beliefs that you have. That's kind of what God did with the people of Israel. They were not organized. They were slaves in Egypt. He took them out there. Eventually he gave them their own country, but he also gave them the rules they should live on. And whether they believed and obeyed the rules, or God was taking his protection away. Right? So, Israel in that time was a rebellion, because they started their own thing. They didn't use any old structures. But when they came into the promised land and they didn't kill all the heretics, let's say, there, all the pagan sun worshippers, Baal worshippers, Mithra worshippers, 666 sun worshippers all around, generally. But they let them live and they took over their traditions. They got infiltrated by that and they fell away from God by the time. So, read the Old Testament for yourself. I don't have to explain all that, but that's exactly what happened. God said it himself. You are a stubborn people. He didn't use the word stubborn, he used another word, but it's coming around that. I think stiff-necked was the word in the Bible, I'm not mistaken. You always want to do your own thing, do you? So, when we go back to the Reformation here, you have to see that when all the reformers identified the papal system with the Antichrist, how in God's name can they think to reform? No, it cannot be reformed. It has to be overthrown. And my second point in there is, why didn't Luther push on the Sabbath? He also kept Sunday. Where do all the Protestant Sunday schools come from? Tell me, please, where you send your children to when you want to have 2 or 3 hours with your own or with your partner on Sunday. Oh, send the kid to Sunday school. Yeah, really? Sunday school? Why? Wasn't the day of worshiping in the Bible, wasn't that the Sabbath day? Wasn't that the seventh day of the week? Wasn't that the Sabbath, the Saturday? Why didn't Luther and no one of the other reformers also, but Luther was the one with this big impact at that time. I mean, Tyndale, okay, he was a great man, but he was more working on the writing, on just translating the Bible into the common word of the people, using the Hebrew and the Greek text, which is fantastic that he did, like Erasmus also, who first covered, I think, the translation from the Greek New Testament into Latin, and later on something else, but that's not the point. But they were more, let's say, they were more working on the software. Luther was working on the hardware. Luther was out there praying to the people and giving sermons to the people and telling the farmers what rights they had and founding a middle class by this free conscience that was given to us and that we were made aware of, and that once we were not bound under the yoke of Rome anymore, we could really use. So he was really pushing this. And to me, he is responsible for that. Now, why, in God's name, why didn't he push the Sabbath question? That is my big question of Martin Luther. I don't know, Michael, are you back? Maybe you want to answer on that?
Yeah, I'm back. That's a darn good question. I wish I had the answer. Obviously, you're not the first one to ask that question. Most of us will get to this point and ask this question, you know, why did they not go all the way? The argument about reforming Satan's church is an impossibility. It's a contradiction. I mean, there's only one way to go about it, you know. The ultimate struggle with all this is who's going to be our master? Is it going to be Rome, or is it going to be Christ, Jesus Christ? And if it's Jesus Christ, then you're going to face this issue. It's interesting with me and Tom Press and Walt Stickle having a conversation about this last night, you know. And I know at least Tom, myself and you and others, and I believe Walt as well, asked this question. Why didn't he not go all the way with it? Why didn't they not, go back to teaching the Ten Commandments? And, one of the answers might be just what you're bringing up, his connection to the Rosicrucians. How much did Martin Luther really want to break away from the church? Or did he just really just wanted to, it's called, reform it. And why weren't they not brave enough to do that? The questions we're raising, I don't kind of find them as condemnations on Martin Luther or other reformers. It's just, at this point, it's asking the questions why. Why didn't it not happen? And until we get those answers, we really don't have a right to condemn them too much. Because we don't know what their circumstances were and how horrendous it was under those circumstances, how challenging it was. So, yeah, I wish I had an answer to that. And if you do find the answer, please pass it on to me.
Well, Michael, I'm sure that I will never can give you the answer because today sometimes it's easy to spot a Jesuit coadjutor. Or somebody who's just putting out there to take the blame for others, like Edward Snowden, Julian Assange. All these people are placed there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't come out with anything by their own. They are just placed there and they play a role. And Alex Jones and David Icke and Tixie Morris, and you can all do very easy research on them and really expose them for what they are. but I don't think that you can go back to the beginning of 1500 and try to expose Martin Luther and where did he really come from and where were his influence coming from. I mean, Martin Luther was almost the same age as Ignatius Loyola.
Yeah. And I just did a show on Wednesday about that. I read chapter 5 of Rulers of Evil, and the irony that they both came out at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And one guy, you know, he was out there translating the New Testament into the common people's language, and the other one was developing spiritual exercises and creating a way of not serving Lord Jesus Christ, but serving Satan. So one was serving Satan, one was serving Jesus. And I don't know. It seems the potential of that happening in that time frame, these two individuals, cannot be by coincidence. It's not that way.
No, it's a little bit like when you look into the Bible, you have David and Goliath. They also lived in the same time frame. They had to do it because they were confronted with each other, right?
Right, right.
Ignatius of Loyola and Martin Luther also were confronted with each other, but not face to face. That's the only difference. But in their struggle, in what they did, the one got a call for, I have to work for Satan and have to see that Satan got dominion over this whole earth, and that's why he proposed to the Pope a new order of monks or whatever, which the Pope first did not agree to. The Pope only agreed after Ignatius of Loyola introduced to the Pope the fourth oath.
Mm-hmm.
You knew that, right?
Well, yeah. Yeah, you know. And then, you know, why was the Pope not too thrilled about that? Because I think they could recognize and see that what Ignatius Loyola was up to was reestablishing the Templar order, if you will, the Templar Knights. But it was going to be under a different form, a different kind of structure. And they had remembered the past. They remembered what it was like and what happened with their last affiliation with the Templars. And so, yeah, it makes sense why there was this kind of doubt and suspicion on the papacy's part. Is this Ignatius Loyola, here's this guy from Spain, you know, who comes from royalty, part of the Illuminati, the Spanish Illuminati.
Los Alambrados.
Yeah, professing that he wants to serve the papacy, the Pope. And it goes in line with what you were talking about earlier, too, about how these different secret societies were vying for control over the papacy, who was going to be in the papacy. Because, you know, whoever's in control the role of the Pope and controlling the papacy, they knew that they controlled the world. And they could dictate what was going to happen. So now we look at someone like Martin Luther, who was, you know, he was a Roman Catholic, a Rosicrucian. Yet God used this flawed man to translate the New Testament into the people's tongue.
Yeah, I don't want to take anything away of his achievements, you know. Martin Luther is a person that is very important in our history. But the question remains, why doesn't he go all the way? You have to go a whole 9 yards.
I think if he did, first of all, I don't think he would have had the support that he needed to have to accomplish what little he did accomplish, which turned out to be a heck of a lot. Now you can remember how absolutely corrupt Western Europe was at the time, right? And
absolutely, yeah.
So, absolutely. You know, yeah. I mean, it's my impression is this, and it could be completely wrong, but those who did go all the way didn't stay on the planet or on this earth very long. they're like the first ones to be, you know, victims of the Inquisition and to be totally destroyed. So I can understand why the early founders of the Reformation would, you know, hang low a little bit, if you will. They would not go all the way just to make sure that the word God got out to people, the truth about Jesus, at least saved by, you know, the Bible and grace and you know, and faith, just grace and faith that we can be saved. And that I could see, I mean, look at our own personal journey as we make it in a decision ourselves to put Christ first, and how in this day and age, how that, you know, there's not too many of us out there, you know what I mean? Our alliances are small and thin. You're not going to be supported by any major group. And, you know, you're going to be kind of be the first one to be left hanging, you know, when things get bad. So I can understand why it happened. And, you know, it's our own personal responsibility, it turns out, who, you know, are we going to be the one, you or I, going to be the one to take it all away? And as long as there's organized religion, it's not going to happen, because it's self-preservation of that institution. And
well, listen, Michael, you know the Bible better than I do, and there is this statement, there's a verse in the New Testament which says, what has righteousness to do with unrighteousness? How can the light walk with the darkness? Something like that.
Uh-huh.
You know the point that I'm making?
Yeah.
So when you see Martin Luther doing this reformation, and then not going all the way, then you have to say, okay, 90% of the truth and 10% of the lie still is a lie, right? So you have to see that agenda behind that. So maybe he didn't address the point of the Sabbath, because that left the door open for the Roman Catholic Church.
Yeah.
Like freedom of religion left the door open for the Catholics in 1776 and the founding of the United States of America.
Well, it definitely did leave the door open. That's no question. Behind it, I don't know why.
When you tell the people they can read the Bible, they can read the Word of God in their own language, and they understand, and they all read, keep holy, remember the seventh day to keep it holy. 6 days thou shalt do all the labor, and the seventh day is the day of the Lord, and you shall take a rest. Something like that it states.
Uh-huh.
And you give all the people the possibility, and they all go to church on Sunday. What's that all about? It's not logical, you know? It leaves something out. Is that, well, you don't tell me that anybody who is so smart as Luther and all the other reformers who were smart people, I mean, when you can translate the Bible from this language to that language, you're not dumb, right?
Right.
So when you can think so far, and you know, when you read the New Testament, you know that you have to keep the commandments. It's in Revelation 20, I think, or is it even 22, in the end of the Bible, where it said that, and those are the people who were following Christ Jesus and keeping his commandments. That means all 10 commandments. And the fourth commandment of remembering and keeping the Sabbath day holy is one of the 10.
Well, you know, your point is well taken. I think what the point is that, you know, maybe I'm wrong. This is what I'm getting from what I'm hearing from you, and what I'm piecing together is that, if you look at Martin Luther's backers, I think it was Ferdinand, right?
Mm-hmm.
And who he was, actually. And we look at the fact that there's this power struggle going on, and who was going to run the papacy and have all these secret societies all kind of vying to bring the papacy down so that they could take it over. I thought they didn't really want to get rid of the papacy. They just want to get rid of the ruling families that were controlling the papacy at that time, and then put their own people in place, you know, could have been, you know, that's a part of the motive that they had to get him to translate the New Testament. Not necessarily for the fact, because you look at Martin Luther's later on in life, is how he treated the peasants and what happened with the Jewish thing and all that. He kind of came a bit of an SOB in the end, which, you know, I can understand too why that would be, because of all the persecution that he was going through. But, you know, you look at it, it could have been just simply now I'm talking about the motives for those people that were in control in Western Europe at the time. Those were in line with Martin Luther backing him. Could those people, their motives really be just to topple the papacy, the ruling families that were in the papacy at the time, so they could put their own people in place, and therefore they allowed this to happen, the translation of the New Testament, with never themselves having the intention of actually giving God's people the freedom and the truth of what God's truth, his laws, his commandments, and encouraging them to follow that. And it's quite clear that's the probable case. And God works in this, this is one of the fine examples of that saying, how God works in mysterious ways, how he uses the wicked to actually reveal the truth. You know what I mean?
Maybe, Michael, that would be an interesting subject to call in Wayne, Walt, and Tom.
Yeah. I think
and
it would.
If you can host me and do a broadcast on that discussion, because Wayne and Tom do have such a deep insight into the Bible that they can maybe come up with an idea, and I think it would be interesting to discuss this point with them on the show.
Right.
Don't you think?
Well, it's a very valid question. It's an important question that I don't know at the end of the day we can actually get the definitive answer, but we come close to it, why things happen the way they happen and why they didn't.
Well, if we can come to an answer or not, it's not important. That we can discuss this point and bring it to people's attention is more important than coming to an end of that, don't you think?
But, let's let everyone know who's listening and who will be listening. I don't think that either one of us are knocking Martin Luther. I think we're trying to understand why they didn't take it all the way. That's why, because life would be so much different in this world if, the leadership of, the Reformation.
I tell you one thing. Rome wouldn't have that an easy job to do if they not only had to deal with the Seventh-day Adventists as the only Sabbath keepers openly, and all the other churches keeping the Sunday. If every Reformation, every congregation that came out of the Reformation kept the Saturday Sabbath, Rome would have a huge problem today. A huge problem.
It would have been the beginning of the dismantling of...
But today they only have the Seventh-day Adventists as one, and they are already since more than 20 years Jesuit infiltrated, and I have a lot of links for that, so anybody who wants to come to me and provide the links of the SDA apostasy, I can advise you to go to the site of Presence of God Ministry from Nicholas. Who has a very, very known page on the FDA apostasy. And I have that also, videos on that, and I have links to that, so that's very interesting. But you only have Seventh-day Adventists, and you have the Jews, who are the true Sabbath keepers today. And there are even Jews who say that they are already turning to Sunday already with this coming thing. But if you had every reformational congregation that came out of there, because today we have 20,000, 30,000 different splinter groups of the Reformation Bible coming in there, and every one of these would really keep the Saturday as their holy day, Rome would play another game than they do now.
Yeah, they definitely would. And you look at that, you're looking at a culture, Western Europe being a sun-worshipping culture that honored this Sunday, the first day of the week, And the challenges that anybody that at that time standing up for the truth that's in the Bible and standing up for the Sabbath day, what they would have gone through, I don't think we can even comprehend it. I mean, look what we go through now, wanting to stand for the God's laws and stand and keep the Sabbath day. You know, whether Western Europe or the Western Hemisphere, you know, it's not, you know, an awful lot of people work on a Saturday. They're not really encouraged to keep the Sabbath day. They're encouraged to keep the Sunday still. And, I can imagine that the pushback just on that one issue alone would have been extremely, it would be tremendous.
Yeah, probably. Okay, maybe let's see that we can get a broadcast on that with a few of our friends together. That would be nice.
Yeah.
Let's see if you can organize it, if you want to organize it, if you can give the topic to Wayne and to Tom and to Walt to talk about, and then we see. But I think we should go on now with our broadcast that I have had planned here.
Okay. it's obviously a question that plagues both you and I, so... You know,
yeah, it bugs me already a long time. It bugs me already a long time since I'm a Christian. I said, why didn't Luther teach the Sabbath? I don't know. But anyway, let's keep from that now and say that it's for another time to talk about, maybe with some input from some of our listeners also who will react to this broadcast. We will see. And I will go into... Now, occultism. So we are still on the subject on the Jesuits and the Vatican, and about how occult symbolism is still visible today when you take, for example, an architecture, Masonic buildings, ancient and new monuments and places and names, corporate logos, money design, think of your $1 bill, the coat of arms, films, especially those from Hollywood, holy days and other cultural rituals, various public accessible cult religions like Freemasonry, fraternities, scouting, New Age societies. Here are some of the Western rituals and festivals with an occult hidden meaning. So I think this is going to be interesting now. Many of which are strongly influenced by ancient Rome and Roman Catholic priesthood culture. First of all, Christmas. December 24th, December 25th, winter solstice celebration, return of the sun and the Son of God. So return of the sun, S-U-N, or return of the S-O-N of God, Son of God. Yeah. I made a video on that last year on the 25th of December called All I Want for Christmas is the Truth About Christmas, and that covers all of that. But Jesus Christ wasn't born on the 25th of December. That is just the day when the sun, after 3 days resting at the same point, moves the first degree back to the north, and by that is being revived or risen from the dead, as they say. The 22nd of December, the sun dies, and then it stays for 3 days on the same, the 22nd, 23rd, and 24th. It rises on the same space, and then it goes back 1 degree to the north until it comes to the equinox, what we call today Easter. But that's another thing. So when it comes back to the northern hemisphere. So that's about Christmas. And then we have an interesting news about Valentine's Day, for February 14th, where you guys all lay on the feet of your women to please them. What's the background of that? Ancient Rome, and likely even pre-Rome, Lupercalia celebration was it called. Note, lupus is Latin for wolf. Lupe means she-wolves. At first, an ancient Roman priesthood fertility ritual, which was later turned into the Roman Catholic St. Valentine's celebration. Sorry. February occurred later on the ancient Roman calendar than it does today, so Lupercalia was held in the spring and regarded as a festival of purification and fertility. Each year, on February 15th, the Luperci priests gathered on Palatine Hill, it's one of the hills of Rome, at the cave of Lupercal. Two naked young men, assisted by the Vestals, the virgin holy female priest of Vesta, sacrificed the dog and the goat at the site. The blood was smeared on the forehead of the young man and wiped away with wool dipped in milk. Roman armies took the Lupercalia customs with them as they invaded France and Britain. One of these was the lottery, where the names of the available maidens were placed in a box and drawn out by the young men. Each man accepted the girl whose name he drew as his love for the duration of the festival, or sometimes longer. As Catholicism began to slowly and systematically dismantle the pagan pantheons, it frequently replaced the festivals of the pagan gods with more ecumenical celebrations. It was easier to convert the local population if they could continue to celebrate on the same days. They would just be instructed to celebrate different people and ideologies. Lupercalia, with its lover lottery, had no place in the new Christian order. In the year 496 AD, Pope Gelasius I did away with the festival of Lupercalia, citing that it was pagan and immoral. He chose Valentine as the patron saint of lovers, who would be honored at the new festival on the 14th of every February. The festival began with the sacrifice by the Luperci, or the flaming Dionysus, of two male goats and a dog. Next, two patrician young Luperci were led to the altar to be anointed on their foreheads with the sacrificial blood, which was wiped off the bloody knife with wool soaked in milk, after which they were expected to smile and laugh. The smearing on the forehead with blood probably refers to human sacrifice originally practiced at the festival. The sacrificial feast follows, after which the Luperci cut thongs from the skins of the victims, which were called fedrua, dressed themselves in the skins of the sacrificed goats in imitation of Lupercus, and ran out of the walls with the old Palatine city, the line which was marked with stones, with the thongs in their hands, in two bands, striking the people who crowded near. Girls and young women would line up on their route to receive lashes from these wipings. This was supposed to ensure fertility, prevent sterility in women, and ease the pains of childbirth. This tradition itself may survive Christianized, shifted to spring in certain ritual Easter Monday wipings. Well, then you have the festival of Carnival, immediately before Lent, the 40 days of Catholic liturgical season of fasting and prayer before Easter, usually during February or March. It may last from a few weeks to several months, depending on the region. Well, that's where they take on masks and other people, and actually that starts in Germany the 11th of November already, Carnival season. Then you have Easter, calculated Sunday between March 22nd and April 25th, spring equinox celebration, resurrection of the sun or son of God, the celebration of the Babylonian goddess of love and fertility, Ishtar. See also the Semitic goddess Asherah and Astarte, combined with the cosmic egg and rabbit, symbolism of fertility and regeneration. Well, because I've never seen a rabbit lay an egg, but it's just symbolism for fertility and regeneration. Regeneration, when you see rabbits go, yeah, okay. See also rebirth and resurrection, the origins of Easter tradition, pagan worship of Easter, blah, blah, blah. Some more words on that. So that's where Easter comes from. And then we have May Day, 1st of May, phallic maypole celebration, Axis Mundi on Thalos. The International Workers' Day is the result of traditional culture suppression and industrial political influence. Then you have Halloween, 31st of October, which I like to prefer for as Reformation Day, where there is the death cult celebrated, even within the Roman Catholic Church. And then there's bullfighting. I really don't have to go about that. Televised sport events are one modern variant of this occult tradition. Yeah. That's for many people also a holy day when their favorite football team is coming on, you know. The elite know many people want to align themselves with the dominators or winners, not the suppressed, the losers. They hypnotize people with simple systems of glorified male competition and domination. A political harmless commercial venting system for the boredom and anger of many people. Well, let's just say give them bread and games. I think I'm quite through this article here. We have now coming up here the connections with the Jesuits and the Sovereign Military Order of Malta with the so-called black nobility. It's also interesting. Examples are the prominent, but certainly not the most powerful, Rothschild family, who are Knights of Malta, and the Rockefeller family, which are Knights of Malta also, who got started using Rothschild financing for American oil field exploitations. These three financial families, the Rothschilds, Morgans, and Rockefellers, all do the bidding of the Jesuit order because of Jesuit infiltration in their organizations. They do whatever is necessary to destroy constitutional liberty in America and to bring the Pope world domination. As we look back over the 20th century, we see how successful the Jesuits have been. They have continued to squander the wealth of America and continually attack its great constitution and civil liberties. Daily, the power of the Pope in Vatican City increases. One day, they will achieve total power again. These wealthy families function as financial supporters and proxies for the large Jesuit and Sovereign Military Order of Malta mafia banking operations. I think I'm quite through this article right now. I don't see anything that is very much interesting here. So I say we are 2 hours on the air, and we can whether go into the next, which would take us long, or we can do that the next time. I was going to read an article from The Unhive Mind, The Jesuit Domination Veiled by Diversion, Agents of Deception. That sounds quite interesting to read, but we can do that another time.
It's up to you, my friend. You can do it now, or, I mean, I'm enjoying it, so. But if you need a break,
I'd rather take a break and do that the next time. I can a little bit prepare of that, but I think the 2 hours that we just had were quite impressive. I mean, I had the intent, I had the idea. It was quite impressive and interesting.
Oh yeah, a lot of information, as usual, and a lot of food for thought. A lot of the connections with. What's going on with Martin Luther, right? I'm still, to be honest with you, I'm still stuck there trying to figure that one out, pondering that, Because that is something that always comes up, and I don't have a great answer to it, so.
Well, it's not that you always have to have an answer on something, but sometimes you just need something to think about, and to reflect on. I mean, it's the same with me. You come into the information about the Reformation, okay, how do we see the Reformation? Yeah, why didn't they go all the way? There had to be a reason. Whether it was a reason why they were, because they were infiltrated, because they were controlled of the position, because it was wanted that way. I mean, when you read the Bible, and I want to finish with that. When you read the Bible, and it speaks about the 1260 years that the Vatican is ruling, that is the period between 538, when the Vatican came into full power, and 1798, when General Berthier, sent by Napoleon to arrest the Pope.
Right?
Yeah. First of all, Napoleon was Jesuit controlled and was a 33rd degree Mason. So that means that God, in his prophecies, in his doings, also uses the enemy to fulfill his prophecy.
All the time.
Right. Right, but can you tell me why this wonderful and important date, maybe 31st of October 1517, when Luther nailed the 95 theses on the church door, or this where we were talking about this this meeting in Speyer that they had in 1529, where the word Protestant first came up.
Uh-huh.
Why these days are they not mentioned in the Bible if the Reformation is so important? Because 1798, that is already 180, 170 years past the Reformation, right?
Right.
The Reformation itself is never mentioned in the Bible. I understand it right. So then I think if that really was a move of God, wouldn't he have written it in his book?
Well, it's a very good question, and
well, maybe we can discuss it in a bigger group, and we'll see to that later. But,
you know, trying to make heads or tails with a lot of what's going on in the world and then connecting it with the Bible is a bit of a challenge. I mean, it really is not just a bit of a challenge. It is a challenge. And if one is honest about that, you know. So and one thing that I am discovering as I go down this journey and as I think I got it all figured out, someone like you shows up and asks some pertinent questions and gets my brain thinking again. It gets me, you know, questioning whether what I know to be true is actually the truth. And I think it's a healthy way of going about it. I know for a lot of folks it's scary. I know a lot of folks it's disturbing because, you know, you get set in your mindset, your mind, in your ways, that you have it all figured out. But, you know, we are not God. We're just mere men. And so we are, unfortunately, just full of a bunch of nonsense and lies, and so we don't have hardly even close to all the answers, you know, about what has been going on in this world and in our lives. So I put my faith in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, the only begotten Son, and that has helped me immensely in this journey, and it's given me hope, and but, you know, I can also understand why somebody who doesn't have faith in him would not have faith in him based on one's own understanding, you know what I mean? So, and as far as the Bible goes, why isn't that to talk more about what happened in the Reformation? Why don't we have a counter-Reformation? Well, how come there's not much talking about today, you know what I mean? Yeah, something happened along the way. I think a lot of it has to do with what we brought up earlier about this whole idea of keeping the Ten Commandments, God's people. How long has it been since God's people have, you know, been here? If that makes any sense. In other words, I'm not saying there has not been God's people on the planet or the earth here during the Reformation or whatever, the past 2,000 years, but I don't know. It almost seems like, you know, after the Christ's resurrection and the death of Stephen, that things really got really dark, really, really dark. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we fully comprehend how dark that is. We're just now coming out of the darkness, if you will, the dark ages. And people will argue and say otherwise, but you know, when I say coming out, that's not a full, complete coming out. I don't think we are ever going to completely come out until the second coming, you know? So, I hope that didn't sound too cryptic, but the problem is, if we're honest men, we don't have a lot of the answers to these questions. But they're worthy of debate and discussion and just see if we can find the answer.
That's right.
But we don't have a lot of the answers that you just, it's the questions that you brought up.
It's not about having the answers, Michael. It's about asking the questions. And it's about seeing that these questions need to be asked.
Yeah, they do. They do. I think it brings a lot of humility to a man. And it brings him back down to the level that he really is. He's just a man. No matter how bright we are or whatever our abilities are, we're not God. So.
No.
So I'm sure everything I just said is not satisfactory. But I wish I had something more profound to say, but I really don't. So.
Oh, that's all right. That's all right. I didn't ask more than that, but let's see if we can get the other guys to come in and do a broadcast together on that subject if they want to. That could be very interesting.
Yeah, well, I will get a hold of them and let's see. Maybe they'd be willing to do that sometime. If most of us should be free if we try, maybe do it later on in the week, next week, and we'll discuss, you know, why they didn't take it all away, the reformers. Why did they not go for it as far as the Sabbath? Why is there such a black hole, if you will, when it comes to our history as Christians in the past 2,000 years? Now, I know a lot of folks will say, well, you know, we got all that early church age history, but, you know, can one truly be honest? Can one be honest and say that how much of that is accurate? We don't know.
Nope.
Really, a lot of the history of Christianity, I mean, has really been tampered with terribly. And
yeah, there's also other subjects, because if you want to start questioning the Bible translations, then you can start questioning about, first of all, using the name Jesus instead of Yeshua. You can say, why is there Amen in the Bible, and doesn't that come from Egypt, Amen Ra? And I will point here to Wayne's website, Avenue of Light, where he has an article about that, where the word Amen, that is first used, I think, in Exodus in the Bible, when they already are out of Egypt. They brought that word out of Egypt. And I happen to agree. I mean, I don't end my prayers with Amen, but let's not get lost here in the details right now and in these little things. Let's just say, okay, we've had our broadcast tonight. I enjoyed myself reading that article that I found there on the connection on the Jesuits and the Vatican and the Supreme Military Order of Malta, connecting all the dots after we came from that travel from Alice Bailey's car, her 10 points, from Lucifer's Trust or Lucis Trust to the 10 Commandments of the Devil, where I still have to make a video from, I have to say. Probably next weekend or so, I'm going to do that. And then I will link it, of course, with the links of the radio show that we did on that also. So we have had quite some kind of a travel. I have, like I told you, prepared a little articles that we can do next time when we do our show. I would see.
Okay.
And by this, I would say I bring it to an end and leave it up to you to see if the other brothers of us are interested in making a broadcast about the things that we just stated and discussed, this Reformation subject, because I think that could be very interesting. But as far as I'm concerned for tonight, I thank the listeners to listen to me, and of course to you, giving me, thank you very much, the opportunity to speak here on the show.
Yeah, that's been great.
I hope to be invited again, and it's Sunday night here, so I hope everybody will have a nice week, and if I don't see anybody before the next Sabbath, I wish everybody to have a nice coming up Sabbath next week, and God bless you and all your families, and thanks for listening, and bye-bye.
Okay. Hopefully we can have one Wednesday or Thursday again. Yeah, that was really good, folks. And for those, you know, I know we ask some quote-unquote dangerous questions that will challenge a man's faith in Lord Jesus Christ, but, you know, I see it this way. Since I've been doing this and asking the honest questions, my faith in Jesus Christ has actually increased. My need for a Savior has increased, believe it or not. So by asking these questions, I can see only one thing. A man or a woman can grow from it. So, and with that, everybody have a great day. So far, next week, I definitely have scheduled Thursday night, Romanism and the Reformation 2014. We'll be talking about flattery, led by Tom Fress. And then I imagine there'll be a couple more shows. Hopefully, Jorg and I will get together Wednesday, Thursday, and we'll see if we can get some other folks to join us in the discussion, either or. So, with that, everyone have a good day. And thanks for those who have listened. And have a good day. All right, bye-bye. See you, York.
See you.
All right, bye-bye.